So in terms of optimization approaches, we actually just looked at a couple different ideas. We just looked at generate and test, this sort of idea of you can just run through all the different values in the input space and see which one gives the maximum. When is that a good idea? When is that not a good idea?
Well, it's probably a really good idea when you have just a small set of things you need to generate and test.
Yeah, it really does require that we have a small input space. And it's also particularly helpful if it's a complex function, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because there really isn't any other choice if the function has kind of crazy behavior, like in the mod example that I gave. All right, for things like calculus, like just solving for what the optimum is analytically, when is that a good idea and when is that not such a good idea?
Well, it's a good idea when you have a function where you can do that. Well, first off, it has to have a derivative.
Right, and so it seems like, well, how are you going to write down a function that doesn't have a derivative? Well, if the thing that we're trying to optimize is some kind of, it could be crazy because we defined it to be crazy. We can define it with little, you know, like ifs and things like that to make it only piecewise continuous. Or it might be that the thing we're optimizing is some process in the real world that we just don't have a functional representation of. All we can do is evaluate the fitness value at different inputs.
Right, or if the inputs are discrete.
Right, like in the first example, right. So it might not actually give us any feedback. The derivative is we're not moving in a smooth, continuous space.
Right. Hey, does mod have a derivative?
Almost everywhere.
Just not everywhere.
Yeah, there's this, you know, because mod kind of looks like, so it has this nice derivative everywhere except for at the jumps.
Which happen pretty often.
Yeah, there's a lot of them, but they're, you know, measure zero.
Hmm. Okay.
Like if you just picked a random number, it wouldn't be at the jump. So it's not only important that the function has a derivative, but the derivative, we need to be able to solve that derivative equal to zero. Newton's method can be helpful even outside of that case, where we have a derivative, and we have time to kind of iteratively improve, right? Just keep querying the function, creeping up on what the optimum turns out to be. So, okay, but then what do we do if these assumptions don't hold? So we have a real, what would that mean? It would mean, what, big input space?
Still have a complex function.
Complex function.
No derivative or difficult to find derivative.
I knew I had that derivative around here someplace.
You know, it's always the last place you find it.
Indeed. Yeah, exactly. And actually, I should have mentioned one more thing about Newton's method, which is that the function has a derivative, you iteratively improve, and it really wants you to have just a single optimum. Because even Newton's method can get stuck if it's in a situation where you have a curve, say, like that. Because Newton's method is just going to hone in on the local peak.
So that would be bad if you have lots of local maxima in this case, or optima,
right.
I suppose.
Yeah. So that's, we can kind of list this as well. Possibly many local optima, right? That the function has a kind of a peak, that things around the peak are less than the peak, but that peak itself may be less than some other peak somewhere else in the space.
Makes sense.
So, as you might expect, that our answer to this hard question is going to be randomized optimization, the topic of today's lecture.